with the coming together of the Meters, the Neville Brothers, and the voices of masking Indians, in 1976, the Wild Chapatulas album was recorded. 4 decades later, it went on to be added to the National Registry of the United States Library of Congress because of its cultural and artistic importance.
That album was the essence of New Orleans' Black Masking Indians. The story of Indian culture and its importance to New Orleans is much older. Join us as we walk through the storied origins of the Indians and ultimately come along with us as we search the neighborhoods of the city for the sound of the tambourine and the sight of brilliant plumage. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm LBJ.
And I'm Christopher Leach. You know, the dance of wind and the wings of birds? That's freedom. And also the exuberant majesty of Black masking Indians' feathers? That's freedom as well. And that's what this special honors, freedom in the Black masking Indians of New Orleans.
This year, WGNO honors the culture of New Orleans' masking Indians inside the Backstreet Cultural Museum. This sacred space in the historic Tremaine neighborhood tells many stories about the social-laden pleasure clubs, the baby dolls, skull and bone gangs, and tradition of New Orleans jazz funerals. Also has the vibrant story of the Indians. The Backstreet Cultural Museum was founded by the late legendary culture bearer and photographer Sylvester Francis. Today, the museum is a nonprofit that has Francis's own daughter, Dominique Francis Dilling, at the helm.
Whew. He left some big shoes for me to fill, but it's an honor. And everyone that walks through the door and get the experience, they give me just that extra boost to keep it going because people appreciate it. They're glad that it's here. And I want to forever keep the doors open where culture bearers could come in and always have a place to highlight their stories and their items.
A great photographer is in the right place at the right time. Starting in 1988, Sylvester Francis began documenting the vibrant soul of New Orleans with his camera lens, including housing Indian suits, which would normally take a year to create with a needle and thread and then be destroyed after being unveiled. Sylvester Francis passed away in 2020. As WGNO honors Masking Indians with this special, we do so in tribute to the life of Sylvester Francis and all he did to advance the culture of New Orleans. Francis eloquently said, "Once you cross over this door seal, you'll enter another world," and that certainly is true.
As we celebrate Mardi Gras in New Orleans, we also join the rest of the country in celebrating Black history and culture, and the Black masking Indians are certainly part of that heritage. You know, we spoke with the Historic New Orleans Collection as well as the Black masking Indians themselves to find out their history.
Historically, not everyone was welcome to be part of Mardi Gras.
You know, only thing we could do for Mardi Gras was carry the flame boat and pick up the horse crap off the street.
Black masking Indians helped to bring inclusion of blacks to a segregated New Orleans Mardi Gras. All of the old line crews of carnival were white, and African Americans after slavery were not allowed into the public parades or crews unless they were pulling floats, carrying riders, or using flambeau to light the night parades. Mardi Gras in New Orleans is as storied as the story of Louisiana itself. Over the years, the crew of Zulu broke the color barrier to establish a crew for African Americans in 1909, and being the first crew to integrate in 1973. Then Councilwoman Dorothy May Taylor furthered inclusion with her ordinance in 1992. But throughout New Orleans' history, Black masking Indians were there, celebrating in the Black communities they were a part of.
We had celebrations in our neighborhoods, and that was a way for us to be able to have our own celebration of what they call Mardi Gras. We called it the Black Carnival Experience.
In 2005, the legendary Chief Tootie Montana stood up against law enforcement breaking up an annual gathering of masking Indians. The effect further boldened the statement that Mardi Gras was for everyone.
We weren't allowed to participate in Mardi Gras, so therefore we had to create our own carnival for Carnival Day.
The points of origin for masking Indians are as countless as the stitches on a suit. Some have criticism saying Black Indian culture is an appropriation of Native American culture. But long before the colonialization of North America, there was a tradition of mask dancing in many ethnic groups in Africa. And then that tradition traveled to the United States as well as other places in the Western Hemisphere like Brazil and Haiti, where carnival celebrations continue today.
They all celebrate in an eerily similar fashion to what we do. And it's all because of the Afrocentric nature of them being able to carry on their African culture in these places where they landed as slaves.
The masking tradition comes all the way from Africa. The dancing and things that happened in Congo Square throughout early New Orleans history. The practice as we know it is really first in the historical record in the 1880s. One of the earliest known photographs of the tradition is a 1915 photograph of Indians at Claiborne and Canal Street.
The enslaved who escaped and ran towards freedom were called Maroons, which is also one of the names some Black masking Indians identify with today. Many of the Black masking Indian tribe members are of mixed ancestry that includes not only Black, but Native American ancestry.
We were paying homage to the Native Americans that helped us during slavery.
But perhaps one of the most well-known origin stories originates back in 1884, when the Buffalo Bill Wild West Show came to New Orleans. Many attended the show, including Black New Orleanians, who were exposed to depictions of Plains Indians, which could explain why the suits seemed to be more alike to the clothing of Plains Native Americans rather than the clothing of Native Americans from the Louisiana area. However, the history that is accepted widely today seems to point towards West African traditions of celebrating, which of course intertwined with carnival.
It was a way for Black New Orleanians to mask their African traditions in this Native American costume.
Each explanation for why they came to be only seems to make Black masking Indians that much more fantastic, legendary, and as real as the tangible feathers that adorn them.
Our culture has always been expropriated. We hold on to it in the effort to protect the culture.
Crafting these living pieces of art takes months of dedication and hard work. Photojournalist Jeff Kent spoke with Big Chief Juan Pardo about the blood, sweat, and tears it takes to make an Indian suit.
I am Big Chief Juan Pardo of the Golden Comanche Mardi Gras Indian Tribe. I have been masking as a Mardi Gras Indian for 20 years. You begin the process of creating your next suit right after Mardi Gras. The suit is what people begin to know us by. But if you look at us as a tribe, then you understand that it's ceremonial regalia. That is what this suit is. This is our traditional ceremonial regalia that we individually make as a sacrifice. You have to give up something. You have to give up time, you have to give up events. And also when you see that suit, you're looking at 1 year of a person's life. I spend until I'm completed, but you can easily be in the range of $6,000 to $10,000. You're $1,200 in just in feathers. That's not buying anything else. When I am in the suit Mardi Gras morning, that's when it's finished and I'm done spending. You get into from 70 pounds to upward of the hundreds of pounds. But I've had a suit on easily over 100 pounds. I don't think anyone's ever gonna sit down and figure out how many beads they've actually sewn. But the best thing to say is a lot. These claws that you see here came from an owl. This owl lost his life. I've wanted to learn how to do taxidermy and how can I preserve these wonderful claws that I saw. And these claws will be on my suit this year as well. When people see my suit this year, you're going to see all the shades and all the skin tones that exist in this colorful, beautiful thing we call Black Masking Mardi Gras Indians.
Inflation has affected everything from the cost of meat and bread to how much it costs to finance a car. Inflation this year has even affected the Mardi Gras Indians because the cost of feathers has gone up dramatically. Kenny Lopez has the story.
Guchima! Chua!
Calvin Williams is a Mardi Gras Indian in the 9th Ward Black Hatchet Tribe. With inflation, it's affecting his ability to make his suit.
Feathers are expensive. When I started, they were like $250 a pound. 1 pound, $250. And now they are, I think, like $650.
Because his tribe orders in bulk, feathers are $450 a pound, but that's still steep. They order the feathers from Africa, they are ostrich, and custom dipped in dye.
You need the money for the feathers. That's what makes the Indian suit.
Look at my spawful.
Night War Black Hatchet, Medicine Man Cal. This big eagle is landing on his shoulders. That's his, like his bodyguard.
Now it's not only feathers and beads that make up these beautiful suits. They also need stones, ruffles, backing, glue, needles, and thread.
To make Medicine Man Cal's suit, it costs about $5,000.
Well, I can go right on Canal Street and get me some beads. I can't go on Canal Street and get no feathers.
And no one wants increasing costs to force beautiful parts of the culture of Mardi Gras to be lost.
Coming up, we've got a spotlight on one of the more famous members from the Wild Chapatulas.
And how Mardi Gras morning used to be a dangerous time for the masking Indians, when our WGNO Mardi Gras special putting a spotlight on the Mardi Gras Indians continues.
Welcome back as we put a Mardi Gras spotlight on the black masking Indian culture of New Orleans from right here inside the Backstreet Culture Museum.
Yeah, well, Mardi Gras Day will be a busy one for one member of the Wild Chapatulas. He's putting the finishing touches on his suit. That is when he's not in the recording studio. Our Bill Wood is listening to his music.
With dental floss, determination, and designer dreams.
Put your finger there so the thread don't frill in between the clasp of the stone.
A New Orleans man spends all year.
A lot of my rhinestones could be purple and gold this year.
Stitching beads across the canvas that will come together with $500 a pound feathers as the suit that transforms him into a Mardi Gras Indian. What does it mean to you to be a Mardi Gras Indian?
I feel like I'm participating in one of the richest cultures in the entire world. I'm kind of blessed to be in this position to be a Mardi Gras Indian, and I feel like it's one of the blackest things any person who knows the history of Mardi Gras can do to participate.
Because he carries the flag for his tribe, his name is Flag Boy. Flag Boy Giz. Giz, short for his nickname, Gizmo. Flag Boy Giz is a member of the Wild Chapatulas tribe, and from the street to the stage, he's the singer who's making the kind of name for himself that gets a photo shoot for the cover of Offbeat magazine. And then...
To respect Native people who aided runaway slaves, artists like Flag Boy Giz wear beaded suits for this event.
He's the answer to a question on Jeopardy.
Bill.
What is Mardi Gras?
Correct.
Flag Boy Giz for $1,000.
Got a crowd walking with me. Everybody got to send me golden gloves like Griffey.
He's also got the answer in the recording studio. When he moves to the microphone, Flag Boy Giz sings the songs from his life.
And I'll be walking to meet them engines in the project. No big secret to it, just what happened and how can you make it like translate in music.
Flag Boy Giz grew up as Aaron Hartley, a fifth generation New Orleans native who studied to be an electrical engineer.
We met the hunters, the Apaches, and the Seminoles.
Before he got into the groove of music videos, he worked for 15 years as a hotel valet while finding his voice.
With some big horns. Just a new spin on traditional music.
Are you a rapper?
I'm just a New Orleans artist, and if the beat calls for rap, if you can rap, pull it out. And if you can't, don't play with it.
The suit
to turn them around.
He sews by hand, sitting on his sofa at home, makes its public debut on Mardi Gras Day with Flag Boy Giz inside.
Because there is only one.
Flag Boy Giz, you better let him know.
It's music for the times and for all time.
Me and him in a magno.
Bill Wood.
Walk away to Kelly.
Flag Boy Giz has already finished album number 3. And get this, he's already working with Raj Smooth, his manager, on the next music move.
Yeah, well, there have been a lot of changes to the Mardi Gras Indian culture over the years. In fact, Mardi Gras Day used to be a very dangerous time for the Mardi Gras Indians. Well, things are different now. In a scene repeated across the city this time of year on Sunday nights, this is Indian practice of the Mardi Gras hunters at the Hollywood Bar in the 7th Ward. And while the practice chants are in preparation of being the prettiest tribe, being a Mardi Gras Indian used to be a much more dangerous sport.
Before my daddy even started dressing, he told his mama, he said, I want a mask. My grandmother told him, boy, you don't want to fool with that, because that was the violence and everything.
Yellow Pocahontas Big Chief Daryl Montana is talking about his father, the iconic Chief of Chiefs, the late Allison Tootie Montana. The history of the Mardi Gras Indians includes violent clashes of different tribes from different neighborhoods decades ago. The younger Montana recalled hearing the stories as a child.
They said my daddy got chopped up on Claiborne by the feet somewhere around there, and his apron fell off and stuff like, you know, you're hearing all these kind of horror stories. And I was like 6 years old, you know, that was frightening to hear your daddy got chopped, you know, but that's how it was violent.
Ironically, the elder Montana was among those credited with moving the culture from one of violence to the pageantry we know today.
He was looking at it more of a competitive thing rather than violent thing. He felt as though if you was calling yourself a bad man to be recognized, you wouldn't even be looked at, because it wasn't about that anymore. It was about being pretty.
In the natural world, the plumage of many birds is the brightest in males. But in the human world, the colorful feathers are not just for the men. Coming up, we'll show you the devastatingly beautiful lady masking Indians.
And with all that work of sewing an Indian suit throughout the year, we'll introduce you to a tribe member whose mission is to make sure that masking Indians can profit from the art they create. After the break.
Welcome back as we honor the Black masking Indian culture of New Orleans from right here inside the Backstreet Cultural Museum.
Yeah, well, when you think of the Mardi Gras Indians, you probably think of men masking and parading through the city of New Orleans. However, women are included inside this beautiful beaded culture. And our Stephanie Oswald spoke with the Black masking queen.
It's a work of art and a piece of history.
So each of these takes about 60, 70, 80 hours, each portrait.
Angel Chung Cutno spent 500 hours creating this Mardi Gras Indian suit that she wore in 2022.
This suit brings me a lot of kind of emotions, and pride is one of them. Not because of my work necessarily, but because of what it represents as far as womanhood. I do notice that when I'm in my suit, women get very excited to see me, and I love that. I love to empower women and represent something to Black women and for the culture. So we're seeing Black women of the past, present, and future. And we have Angela Davis, and she's actually on a black beret, and then Queen Nefertiti.
In black masking culture, Angel is a queen as well.
So I'm the big queen of the Black Seminoles of the 8th Ward. So we have our chief, and we have a wild man, and then we have me, the queen. So we're a very small tribe. I was saying my ancestral prayers this morning, and in part of it, I say, you know, I'm root of your root, blood of your blood, soil of your soil. And to me, it's about representing who I come from well,
and carrying on our stories and carrying on the stories that I don't even know, that I've never heard, and to create a legacy in that way that the tradition is always carried on.
The day we met, it was crunch time. Fewer than 2 weeks until Mardi Gras, and her third suit was still in the works.
This is a year-round project for you. This is not a couple weeks before Mardi Gras we start this project.
I take my work with me everywhere. I have a little bag. I sit in staff meetings and I bead. I bring it to cafes. I was beading on the airplane yesterday. Because if I don't have it with me, then I'm thinking about doing it.
There's been a parade of creations since 2019.
This is the first piece that I ever did. It took me 100 hours.
All made with no formal training.
I truly feel like this was a gift given to me from the ancestors because nobody ever taught me this. I just sat down and did it one day. And then this is my tambourine. Every Indian has a tambourine, and so this represents both my Afro and my Asian identities.
According to Mardi Gras Indian tradition, each suit can only be worn for 1 year, and the finished products aren't revealed until Mardi Gras Day.
It's about the cultural aspect and that this doesn't exist anywhere else in the world. And that's so grounding, you know, it just reminds me, like, this is bigger than me. This is bigger than this suit. This is bigger than all of the suits put together. This is about a story that we are just continuing to tell.
Storytelling art on display in the streets of New Orleans.
There are over 40 different masking Indian tribes in the city of New Orleans, part of a larger culture bearer community.
You know, some of those include the brass bands, the baby dolls, poets. You know, all of these culture bearers contribute to some of the most iconic photographs of the city of New Orleans. But that begs the question, how can these photographs benefit the culture bearers themselves?
The average suit minimum is $5,000. We put the suits on and we go parade in the street. A photographer takes a picture and he gets the money. People do come here to see us.
With a keen eye and an early rise, and perhaps a bit of luck, one can find one of New Orleans's most coveted sites, a masking Indian tribe on Mardi Gras morning. And year after year, visitors and locals alike have their cameras at the ready. But in 2024, the artistry has evolved as being one of the most iconic symbols of New Orleans's carnival. Mardi Gras brings in close to $1 billion on average each year, but little of that is returned to the culture bearers that make it world-renowned. The answer for some Indians is to copyright their suits and secure a profit.
You file in the Library of Congress under sculpture art. And then they will give you, you can do up to 5 suits at a time. When you copyright your suit, it's no longer public domain, which means if a photographer takes a picture of you and he doesn't pay you, you have the right to sue them.
In recent decades, Eric Burt, the trail and drum chief of the Monogram Hunters Masking Indians out of the 7th Ward, has made it his mission to promote ownership of branding among New Orleans's culture bearers. But in order for Indians to take ownership, Burt says they need to join together to raise awareness. And in that spirit of togetherness, 4 years ago, Burt, along with masking Indians from tribes across New Orleans, recorded music under the group name Nation of Gumbolia. For Burt and others, it's about more than money. It's securing the funding of one of the city's most visible hallmarks of carnival, so that masking Indian culture continues to be part of the story of Mardi Gras.
But the younger generation that's coming up, these are the ones I'm sitting down talking to. These are the ones I'm hipping them to the game, how to protect yourself. And if you don't have the copyright, the one thing you can do is close up. You see them photographers? Close up, cover up. You know, and don't give them that shot that they want.
Coming up, I've got my love letter, a tradition I've kept strong over the years, when WGNO's special, putting a Mardi Gras spotlight on Black masking Indian culture, returns. For close to a decade, we followed the Mardi Gras Indians for news coverage. However, for most of my life, I've been chasing the Indians. It's something that I love. Most fans of black masking run across our culture during the course of Mardi Gras Day, but to really immerse yourself, you have to be deliberate and you better wake up early. Our day starts before the sun comes up with the centuries-old tradition of the Northside Skull and Bones Gang. They're the first to wake up the city on Carnival Day with a warning that you could be next. From there, it's on to chase the Mardi Gras Indians. Chase is the operative term here because, unlike Mardi Gras parades, there is no route published in the media. To be fair, there is no one neighborhood where the Indians roam, but every neighborhood in the city has its share of feathers and traditions. That's the iconic chant, Indian Red. First recorded by the great Danny Barker in 1947 and heard at the beginning of every Mardi Gras Indian gathering, proclaiming we won't bow down on that ground. From there, the chants pick up and the Indians make their way across the city, meeting other tribes throughout the day and most often making their way to Claiborne Avenue in Treme. From uptown to the West Bank to down in the Lower Nine, the Indians are on the street on Mardi Gras Day with the goal of representing their tribes and proclaiming who's the prettiest. Thank you for joining us in this celebration of the black masking culture in the city of New Orleans. And we're also thankful to the Backstreet Culture Museum for letting us arrive in this sacred space.
That's right. You know, you can see all of the full stories and the special itself on WGNO.com. But before we let you go, we want to give you a look at some great archival video of the Black Masking Indians of New Orleans.